Okay.
So, actually, first, thank you really for this ad hoc. Since you've been in Rijeka, we wanted you, actually, our students, to see you a little bit, meet you, and you know, Radin, we started with this prop theater, actually, acting and media program, and. I think it would be interesting maybe if you could tell us something about your education.
Yeah.
Yes, your journey and becoming an actress and yes, it's for us as educators it's always also like a question what to start, where to start, what to give young people, and I think it's always interesting to hear experiences, different experiences.
It is, isn't it? Yes. Well, I started when I was 4 years old, during the Second World War, and we were had been evacuated into the countryside, away from London, where we lived, and my brother was 2, and I was 4, and we stayed with an old aunt in the country, and there was a 6-year-old boy, and he had a little toy theatre, and he put scenes and characters on sticks, all in old-fashioned costume, and I thought, this was wonderful, absolutely wonderful. And then he had this brilliant idea. He said, I'm going to write, you're going to learn the words, and we'll do a play. A play, what's that? Okay, so I learnt the words, and my brother didn't have any words, which was, he was 2. Okay, so my speech, my very first speech I had to learn by heart, was a long list of items, including toothpaste and washing powder, handkerchiefs. There wasn't such a thing as Kleenex in those days. And about 30, a list of 30. And so I came on and I had a, he'd found a dress, this boy, his name was Stephen. He found me a dress, a long nightgown to wear to look like a dress, and a handbag. He was the director and the writer. And he rehearsed, and then he sent invitations to everybody he could think of, so we had an audience of 9 people in a nice room, and he said, we're going to charge a 0.5 for each person. And on these 0.5, there was a ship. And that was, the audience had to pay. 9 people came. So there was 9 0.5, which meant, what did it mean? 4 full pennies. And a half. So we were already a huge success. And then I came on from the back of the room to the audience, like you, 9 people. And I began my speech. I am shipwrecked. I have landed on this island. I have nothing left except. And I began to say my list of all the things that I still had in my handbag. And then around about the 6th item that I had not lost, I couldn't remember all the others. And I found that I was staring at all these people, and they were staring back at me, and nobody would say anything. And eventually my friend, aged 6 years old, the writer and director, said, "Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry, Vanessa has ruined everything, and we're going to start again." So that was my initiation into the world of theatre. My parents weren't there, it was the war. My father was in the Navy, in the fighting, and my mother was in a play touring the countryside, earning a little bit of money to pay for us to be fed. And of course, from that moment onwards, you might think, well, I would never want to know about theatre again, but then we found there was another angle to this excitement. The other angle was, he could write a play, I could write a play. Okay, so we began this cycle, and I wrote the next play. I was so excited that I told a huge lie. We rehearsed six scenes, which I had invented already. But then I said, well, now there's a lot more scenes than I've told you about. Many more scenes. And I'll just have to tell you, and maybe we rehearse some today and some more tomorrow. I'll have them ready for you to learn the words tomorrow, Stephen. So this was my first writing a play experience, as well as acting. And then when we came back to London after the war, I was 5 years old, and my parents took me to meet a very famous woman called Madame Rambert. And Madame Rambert had been a very famous ballerina, but now she ran a school, a ballet school, and a ballet company. And my father's best friend was a dancer called Diana. And Diana, much later, married Yehudi Menuhin. But at this time, she wasn't married. She was a dancer, of course, earned no money at all, because mostly dancers in those days couldn't earn any money at all. Very much like actors, but worse. And she suggested I go because this was the company she knew. So at five, I began the classical ballet, and this was what I wanted to do. I wanted to dance more than anything else, because I loved the music. I loved everything. I loved repetition. I loved these endless routines of again and again and again and again. And then eventually we'd get to some enchaînement, and I could fly across the room from that end to that end, covered it in four. And all this wonderful music playing on the piano. And then I studied ordinary school, did some performances in ordinary school, which included playing St. Joan, which was very exciting when I was 14. Very exciting. But I still wasn't sure. I thought, maybe I want to be a teacher. I don't know why I thought I could be a teacher or what I would teach. No idea. However, eventually, I'll skip some years, and eventually I did an audition, and I got in for one school, and I got into the one school. And my father paid for me to have singing lessons outside the school because, strangely enough, they didn't. At the time, of course, I didn't think it was strange. I thought, this is a drama school, they don't sing. I'm not going to a singing school. Of course, when you think about it, how terribly wrong. But that was how things were. Even though the school emphasized the need for training for the voice, they didn't really have good singing lessons, which is incomprehensible to me. But that's how it was. So my father paid for me to have wonderful singing lessons twice a week with a Hungarian called Jani Strasser. And he gave me lessons that still, even now, I think of some of the things he told me, and I find them still even more helpful than I did very early on. For instance, he told me, this was very important to me, particularly as the classical ballet is very disciplined, it's very formal, and you do it this way and you don't do it any other way. And you work very, very hard and you expect nothing except for your muscles to obey you and do what the choreographer has asked for. But so I tended to try and control everything that I was doing. I had this tendency, perhaps it was also because of the war, because I don't know what. But Jani gave me wonderful exercises, and I still do them to this day when I'm warming up before a show. Singing ones, of course. And he stopped me one day, and this is priceless. He said to me, "Ta-ta-ta, just think of this. You have a lot of little poodles." He meant dogs, right? Little dogs. "You have a lot of little poodles. And you, Vanessa, you're holding them very hard and making them go where you want them to go. And they're very obedient, dear, good little poodles. So they try to do everything you want. But if you let them go, they will be far more extraordinary than what you're trying to make them to do. They will do everything even more than you ever imagined they could or should do." And that still, he used to teach singing at the Glyndebourne Opera House. And he taught my father singing. My father played the piano and beautifully, perfectly, and he sang too. He sang everything. He sang Schubert. He sang in German because he'd been to Heidelberg. German was his second language. In fact, he even thought King Lear was best in German. He did. It's extraordinary. Very extraordinary. I remembered that the first time I went to see King Lear in a German production in Hamburg. I remembered what he'd said. Anyway, and then my education continued once I got my first job, which was playing 12 different parts in 12 weeks, all of them old. Of course, I thought anything old was from 50 over. And I was quite clever already from drama school at being able to do lines under my eyes, at the corner of my mouth, up in the middle of my eyebrows, along the top of my forehead. I was really good. I knew how to highlight them. Now remember, this was, well, you couldn't remember because you'd done nothing about it. This was This is all after the war, so there wasn't anything that you could get. If you had a lot of money, I suppose you could get a lot more. But the makeup was very primitive. It was the old grease paint. How do you say grease paint?
Masnoboya.
Uh-huh. Yes, yeah, the heavy. The heavy.
Yes.
Not none of this, pour a little in the back of your hand and then... No.
Making same things. You know.
Really?
Yeah. Even now.
Oh, Urban, sorry, I didn't see it. Oh, yes, well, you had a great writing there. But I loved doing these lines. I thought I'd got pretty expert with the lines, playing a range from 50 to 90 years old. Oh, yes, I can do it. So my first job was playing a whole range of old ladies, including the mother of the 30-year-old actress who was leading the company. I played a very awful, stern mother in a play that had been a big success 2 years before in the West End of London. And I scolded and tormented and dictated to this very good actress, Pauline, who was 30, and at the time I was 20. So I was really committing to age and severity and my lines. So that was a big education, those 12 weeks. And then I was very, very lucky. I got a job doing pantomime, the English, extraordinary English experience of the fairy tales of Grimm, but turned into romantic stories. The old English tradition, it doesn't exist anymore. I think maybe very few theatres. But there was the story of Cinderella, there's the story of Beauty and the Beast, there's the story of Jack and the Beanstalk, there's the story of Snow White, but the English version, they're all modern songs, popular songs, or they were popular songs of the particular time, and women play the men, and men play the women. Now, if you can do that, you can do anything. And at that time, it was unheard of anyway that there should be any discussion about there being any other kind of sex whatsoever. It was a popular form of theatre that was performed in the Christmas period. So ancient, when I tell you about it, I think, my God, how long have I lived? So I got a job and I was Jack and the Beanstalk. And there's a certain kind of, I probably am going to break down and cough and not be able to sing, but the piano is accompanying, you see. And then I've got my little shorts. It's very sexy. Kind of hoping to be, anyway, you're meant to be. And blouse and little strap and a cap with a feather and a blouse, sort of. And I couldn't see unless I had spectacles on, and of course I couldn't wear spectacles. I was the principal boy, Jack. So I think I remember a few lines. Dum da da dum 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 dum. The whole thing started when I dropped for bed. A golden sun was driving overhead, and in an apple tree a blackbird said, "What a day, what a day, what a day. I'm off to see a little girl called Jill. I've got a meeting by the water mill." That kind of song, you know. weird. So that's my basic training. Do you want to know anything else? I can say this and that or whatever, whatever you would like. But that's the first part of my education. I suppose the second part was I got, a little bit later, I got the part of a daughter of a school teacher in the story who's being played by my father. And I got the job without a doubt because my father wanted me to have the part. And the producers, I met the producers, they terrified me. But I was in awe of the excitement of having a part. Part of this girl who's the daughter of a school teacher. And it was the old three-act dramas. It was a modern play. We're talking about 1959. Three acts, two intervals, and in the afternoons when we played, some ladies in the audience would like their tea brought. And they'd come in the interval, 15 minutes, and there'd be clink, 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 as trays are passed down the rows, clink, 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 more trays down the road, stirring of teacups, dropping of sugar lumps into the cups. And then just as you're starting the next act, clink, 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 clink. So it was an interesting experience, but the audience seemed to prefer it that way. And I learned two more lessons then from my father. We used to walk home after rehearsals because I still lived at home at that point. And he said, so one day as we walked back home, he said, so what did you think about rehearsal today? So I said, well, I felt very unhappy. I didn't feel I knew what I was doing. He said, yes, and you let everybody know it. So then I learnt that lesson, which is you can be feeling unhappy with what you're doing because this is bound to happen. How could you do anything if this didn't happen quite frequently because you're dissatisfied with what you're doing? But what does it solve making everybody else miserable because you're feeling miserable? Nothing. It doesn't help you solve the problems you're encountering, and it makes everybody else think they'd rather be somewhere else. So I learned that. And the other thing I learned was to not equate what a particular character was feeling and thinking with how I would think and feel. And this was major learning step. Because I said, well, I'm not very happy because, you see, I don't think the character was a girl called Caroline. I said, I don't think Caroline would do that. I don't feel like that when something like that happens. And he said, but you're not Caroline. I said, what? I'm not Caroline. Well, who else is Caroline? Excuse me. Thinking, didn't dare say that. So he said, what you can imagine already, he said, Caroline is a different young girl from you, and you better start finding out how she thinks and feels. So that was a first major lesson, because although I'd read everything Stanislavski had written, at drama school, everything he'd written, plus every single other teacher had been translated into English, of which there's a considerable number, or was at that time. My father had got all the books, and he allowed me to not take them away, but to read them, put them back in the shelf. So I'd read An Actor Prepares, of course, and I'd read several other books which apparently Stanislavski had written. Plus a guy called Mikhail Chekhov, who'd become a refugee in Britain at some point, a couple of others. And of course, they're talking about the preparation. What happens if what the plan seems to be with what you, if you cannot understand, at a certain moment you get a block and you cannot understand what the character would be thinking or feeling, and the director's told you what to do and you do it, but nothing happens inside. You're just doing it from the outside. And I'd read those and I'd been thrilled with the books. I saw what the kind of work, which we never studied at drama school at all. It was very much the English way of trial and error. If it works, great. It's not working, bad. But no examination of what is the scene about beyond the most elementary discussion. That used to be the English way. I don't know what, things have definitely progressed since then. Absolutely, definitely. But you'll find English actors not too excited of talking about acting. And I don't know why, because I think it's, well, I love to hear other people talk about acting, but I don't get enough chances, actually. I wish I was sitting in the audience and Rad and Link were talking about acting. Where would you like to go from here? Link, have you got an idea?
Well, always you are welcome to raise your hand and also keep asking questions. I invite you. But it's really, Vanessa, everything, it's interesting what you are saying. I mean, today, how do you prepare yourself?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, isn't it? Because, especially because you're a director and you have directed me.
Yes.
But we worked on a Shakespeare play, Lenka and I, at the Globe Theatre in London. And I made one huge mistake. Lenka could tell you of many others, but I'm not going to tell you all the others. The huge mistake I made was that I had been invited to play Prospero by Mark Rylance, who at that time was the artistic director of the Globe. And I said, yes, I'd love to. You won't believe this, but it is true. Well, I never asked myself enough, why did he ask me to play Prospero? Everybody else was the same sex as the character they were playing. But I'm playing Prospero. Now, I have done certain films, and unusual, exciting films based on true stories. One of them was an American, whatever you call it, anyway, big show drama, in which I played the true story of a terrific tennis star who was convinced that he was a woman. In other words, a transsexual.
But this was a long time ago, before.
Oh, long.
There was so much.
Oh, a long time.
And openness.
No openness whatsoever.
I remember, yeah, more than 20 years ago when we came to her place.
85.
I found the VHS
of
that and put, I was like, I couldn't believe.
Well, I played
an amazing step forward.
This tennis star who's convinced they are transsexual, who meets with complete incomprehension, refusal, has a mother who's a psychiatrist who is just horrified, and who does get the operation eventually and become a woman after many very difficult experiences. And I explored, of course, this is on film, so it's not the same as theater, and went to a wonderful makeup artist, very unusual, brilliant makeup artist. And there we were in the studio doing some day of makeup tests. And he said, well, there's various things that signify the typical general, I'm not going to use that word normal because it doesn't exist. Said men have an Adam's apple, women don't. And men have protruding skull here, and women don't. Now already, of course, that's a complete simplification, but anyway, he spotted that. He said, also, there's the widow's peak, so we'll shave your hair. So we got there, and I was terrified. I actually looked just like my father when he was young. Oh my God! Oedipus, or something. Help! What's going on here? It was extraordinary working on the voice, of course, but then most of all preparing by listening to transsexuals explain to me how they felt and how they first, the stages by which they'd come to realize that they were not what it appeared they were from their everything physical. And everybody was telling them it was a psychological problem. So you go to a psychiatrist and you'll get over your problem of thinking you're really a woman, or the other way around, thinking you're really a man. That was a huge eye-opener. But now I've got, now back to Prospero. So, the huge mistake I made, and I don't know why I never went to Lenka and said, Lenka, you know I'm in trouble. You know that I don't know what I'm doing. But I guess I was too arrogant, you know. I thought that I'd been asked by Mark to play Prospero because I was so good at playing men. That's not what Prospero is about, of course. You can't get anywhere with that. But I became convinced, and I was into, and I was saying, no, you, Lenka, it's all right. She said, I'm going to be a man, you'll see. God, I can't believe it, Lenka. I can't believe it. So, of course, I'm getting myself a moustache and I'm wearing my heavy boots. I ask Rada, can he lend me a pair of boots? It's true, isn't
it? I wanted to ask you, why you asked me to play in my boots and...
What?
In Kalija's hat.
Yes.
What I was wearing at that
time. Yes, yes.
And she knew this story about Kalija, about his hat, you know. And I was telling her a little bit about Kalija's life and this kind of his bravery, you know, and how he, sorry, it's all that's happened to me. Ne mogu s tobom razgovarati jer upravo sam sjedim kraj Vanese Redgrave i ona našim studentima. Ali si pozva za sutra da igramo tenis sa njom, kod Dragana u Remetincu. U 12:30, da, doviđenja. Doviđenja, nemaš sad više vremena, zdravo. That's Vaske, remember Vaske?
Oh my God.
And yeah, then I told her this story about Kalesha, what was very interesting for her, what she was interested in about Kalesha was not only that he was one of the greatest writers in Europe, this kind of his position and his action and his fight, you know, for some kind of truth and you know, and his kind of how he was brave during the Second World War and all of these things, you know. And I think it was the reason why she wanted to fill this collection.
Yes, and I went to try and find a moustache just like Radha's. As well,
because as she wanted to touch a refugee. As Prospero was, right?
Prospero was a refugee. This was this particular attempt to come from the outside in to the character. But it was, I wasn't good as Prospero because of this conviction that I had. And it got in so deep. And I was talking very deep voice as Prospero. Ye hills, elves, and oaks of... I don't know. But I did enjoy it. And one wonderful thing happened. This is just one of those things that can happen, accidents that are kind of exciting. And you can never repeat them, but you think, okay, that was my Prospero on that night. Well, not night, because you know the globe is open air and they have very minimal electricity. So it's daytime playing, basically. Did we ever play at night? Just the summer.
The lights,
they had a few lights,
yes,
too.
So it just looked as if it's a day.
Yeah. But one day there was a thunderstorm and lightning and all these exciting things. And I had of course, this wonderful staff. And there's the moment when Prospero says, that with my magic, and I raised my wand, broke the yokes in half and... And as I raised it to the peak, the lightning went and the audience were thrilled. I was thrilled, so I thought, I'll do it again. I smiled and I raised my staff to the heavens. And then I thought, well, play it safe, I won't try it a third time.
For me, the most exciting moment in this production was when you were standing near this Tesla's magnetic egg.
Yeah.
And touching this and telling this beautiful story about dreams.
That
was here, not Prospero.
Yes.
It was something like Tesla was there, like Tesla woman.
Yeah.
Like your voice was completely yours without any performing, and it was the most exciting moment for me in this production.
Well, that was very exciting. Very exciting. But I've seen quite a lot of Prosperos, and they were all brilliant actors. One was my father, Rafe Vines. But I didn't ever think it was really, because I couldn't understand what Lenka was feeling for. I'd got this kind of hard shell that I was trying to fit myself into. I was convinced, and I was so convinced that I couldn't be open to Lenka and what she was looking for in the play and in Prospero. So I wasn't good. Okay. Anyway, c'est la vie. Do you want to ask anything? Or?
Well, be part of
capacity of yours to be one and the other in Virginia Woolf's Orlando.
Well, I know what you're talking about, and I didn't actually play that character. I always wanted to. Mm-hmm. Always wanted to. And you know, there's a tricky thing that now I've figured it out, but at the time I didn't. When I was very young, starting on work in professional theatre, perhaps because I've my four-year-old experiences, I thought if I believe something, I can be anything. Anything I believe in, and the audience will believe too. Simple. That simple. So this actually happened, but it is something I think that can happen to actors, and certainly happened to me much, much later on, after a lot of experience. Almost incomprehensible that it happened. I was playing for 1 week a sort of strange comedy that we'd played in my 10 weeks summer season, and we went to Cambridge and we played for 1 week there, and I was thrilled. We're going to Cambridge. This is my second professional job. And I was playing a woman who's described in the text. Of course, the audience never get to read the text. But the text says, you know, she's short and she's plump and she rushes about and she talks very fast and she's plump, plump, and she runs everywhere. So I imagine myself short, and plump. Okay, I couldn't get a plump body to put on. A cushion didn't seem to work, so I thought, I'll imagine it. I'll imagine I'm plump. And then, because I thought I'm convinced in my belief that I'm actually short and that I'm actually plump, I found myself doing strange movements. Oh, sorry.
It's okay.
I found myself doing these strange movements. And I earn a salary. My father comes up to see the play. I'm so excited. I'm so nervous. And we have some tea afterwards. He came to see an afternoon performance. And I look at him, and he had this way of looking very serious and very Prospero sort of looking. And I said, well, so what do you think? He said, what do you think you were doing? And I said, well, who are you playing? I said, well, you see, she's short and she's fat and she's out of breath and all. He said, but you're not short and you're not fat. And I said, well, I'm imagining that I am. And he said, but we in the audience don't know what you're imagining. We can see somebody who's tall and thin. And so to us, it's absolutely crazy that you're doing these strange movements and you're running about in a tiny little steps. You've got long legs, you take big steps. And I can't understand it when you cross the stage from one side to the other with these little steps. So that's where I learned that while there is no limit, there also is. In other words, it's a quantum situation, and you have to work with your colleagues, and if you're lucky, with some people who've got a lot of experience, and they can explain to you what you need to do to realize and truly communicate. Because, in other words, if you are very tall and very thin, it doesn't make any sense for you to pretend to be short and fat. You better find out what sort of character this person is who you're playing and play that. Anyway, the other kinds of preparation are different, of course. There's the preparation of appearing to know how to do something that you don't know how to do, which is very exciting. And I'm just talking about something a little bit silly, really, because when I filmed Julia with Fred Zinnemann, there was a montage scene in which my character, Julia, was sailing a boat. And I love to learn how to sail a boat, and I just about got the hang of it. But, oh dear, no, it's film. And they like it more doing it the way you never do it in real life. You have to do the opposite, which means you're not really sailing. Now, there's that kind of preparation, which is an important one. Of course, there's the preparation, which all of us know about, when you have to learn an accent. And that's interesting because, as I found out, I played a Scottish school teacher in a play that became very famous and then was a film too. So I learned how to speak in Scots all the time. But then I worked so hard to be really good that I made a prison for myself. I couldn't get out of this prison of speaking like this voice. And so I said, what do I do, to some friends? It was John Osborne, actually. John Osborne and his wife of the time came to see the play, and I said, well, we all don't know what on earth to do. The writer's awful. She doesn't trust the director. We're having a hard time. And I just feel like I can't do this. I can speak Scottish, but I don't know the character. And they said, well, stop doing Scottish. It won't matter. Stop it for a while. Do play her in English. Being Scottish isn't the most important thing about this woman. The most important thing is who the woman is. What are her dreams? Why is she teaching? What is she hoping to put her children through to make them be like she wants to be and can't be? This is more important than talking Scots. So I asked the director, I said, do you mind if I just don't speak Scots? And which seemed to be a huge big step. And he said, no, I think you should. I think it's probably good advice. So I stopped speaking Scots, and as soon as I stopped speaking Scots, my mind could start exploring, who is this woman? So that's that version. But then there's the other way around. I was playing Orpheus Descending in 1989, and with a very good director. And I loved Tennessee Williams, and I knew Tennessee Williams very well. He was, a close, close friend. So we come to the first public performance, which is not in London, it's in Cardiff, the south of Wales. And I go down there. But before I head get onto the train, I take a call from Los Angeles, which is my husband, we're divorced but very close, Tony Richardson. And he's asked me questions about playing this lady. Now, In Orpheus Descending, the lady is a first generation immigrant from Sicily, and she's in America. That's the ground of fact. Build up, who is this lady? And so identified with Sicily that she's done an act as a little girl, as she tells, with a monkey and an organ, playing the organ. That's how she and her father earned money in when they first came to America. So Tony's asking me about playing and so on and so forth, and he said, and of course you're playing her with a Sicilian accent. Well, no, actually, no, I'm playing her with an American accent, because we figured out, the director and I, that that she, being a child, she would have wanted to speak like everybody else, so she would be. He said, you're mad. You are mad, he said, in that kind of voice. Mad. He said, she's got to be Sicilian, through and through and through. You can't play her with an American accent. So I thought, oh my God, what do I do? I've got 5 hours, and in 5 hours' time, I'll be in my dressing room, getting made up, getting my clothes on, being Sicilian, not American. So I went to my director and I said, I think I've got to play her with a Sicilian accent. Now, because of things I won't go into, I've spent an awful lot of my life in Italy. Loved Italy, still love Italy, etc., etc. So it didn't seem to me awfully difficult to be playing with a slightly Sicilian accent. It's different, in fact, from Neapolitan. And Rada was playing a wonderful song, weren't you? Who was it, Bruce? Who was singing it? Who was singing car, that song in the car?
In a car.
Was it Renzo? Wonderful Neapolitan song from Naples, it was.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I can't remember. Anyway, it was very close, and it's a wonderful sound. And when you know anything about Sicily or Naples, it's another world. It's quite different from Rome, completely different from Rome. And of course, if you're an immigrant, it's completely different. And if it's your identity, and your father's been killed, and you are Sicilian, and you... So I said to Peter Hall, I think I should try to play her in Sicilian. And he smiled and said, I think that would be a good idea. So I went out on stage. No, before we went on stage, we're all sitting in a ring doing a word run of all the words in the play. So I do them in sort of Sicilian Neapolitan. And the other members of the cast are looking at me, my God, Vanessa's gone crazy. Something's happened in London. What is she doing? And Peter is there and smiling away, so they look at him, and Peter doesn't seem to be appalled. So they think, oh, okay, so he said it's okay, so we've got to say it's okay. What the hell is she doing coming in here at the last minute talking Neapolitan? For Christ's sake. So that's the other way around of it. And I did it like that, and we did an American TV film, and it's reasonably good what I did. So there's preparation. It's now quarter past six.
No, we
have some more time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I want to say one night joke. It happened in Venice. It was
shall I bring you some tea?
Yes.
And that year I had a film Before the Rain, and we won Venice Film Festival. Mm. And Uma Thurman was a president of Jew. Or member, I don't know, I think president, yeah. And Vanessa, that year she won Walpie as the best actress on a festival. And she asked these people from festival that I had to collect her award. And they said, okay, there was a little bit of surprise, you know, but they said, okay. And I remember that year when she got this award that some journalists who had protected some Italian actress, you know, to get this award, they asked on press conference Uma Thurman, how is possible that Vanessa Redgrave, we love her, she's the greatest actress in the world, but how is possible that she got this Walpie Award when she was only 5 minutes in the film? And Uma Thurman answered, but don't you think it was the best 5 minutes on a festival?
Oh, really?
But it's not the end of this joke, of this story, you know. And I collected this award. And I remember flying, you know, together with Uma Thurman back to London. She was afraid of flying. Terrible. And I came to Preben Mansion on Chiswick, where at that time we lived with Vanessa in her apartment. And I came there, Lenka wasn't at home, and Nina wasn't there. Vanya was just born, right?
Mm.
Almost in her apartment. And she was in the kitchen preparing lunch for us. She was preparing her famous chicken, you know, with some beautiful sauces around, you know. It's why I stopped to eat chicken, you know. It was almost every day.
It was every day. Every day.
And she was cooking, and she said, oh, Radhe, congratulations for your film. I said, thank you very much. I was waiting. It was terrible for me to say. You know, I said, Nancy, I must tell you something. She said, what happened? I said, you know what? I lost your award. It was 1 second, you know, silence, and then she started to laugh and laugh. And she said, what happened? I said, you know what? I was drinking whole night from this Walpie, you know, it's like a big golden bowl. I was drinking wine from this, you know, I lost somewhere in some restaurant. And she started to laugh, and she said, from now on, it will be the most wonderful award I got. Why I'm telling this? Just because one reason. Knowing this lady, this sister Vanessa, what I realized, you know, even she is, as many people from our profession thinks, the best actress in the world, I never felt, never really, that she is pretending to be an actress. And that she's, you know, thinking about acting at all. Always, you know, I lived 2 years with her in this apartment, and knowing her more than 20 years, we are friends. She's always interesting in the books. She's always surrounded with some different new papers, you know, trying to find what's going on in the world and everything else. In the world, politics, things what happened, wars, some poor people who are without houses, you know, on the streets, in terrible situations, for her are more important. So it's something what is special. And what I'm learning somehow, you know, about actors like...
No, you didn't ever have to learn that. You never had to learn that.
But you know what? If we have... Okay, for last question you can ask, and then I just want to say, okay, Nebojša, I'll give you... I just want to say it's our first meeting. What I would like, and Anes, I talked with Lenka, we were talking about Vanessa, with Vanessa about this, that we'll organize on Brioni during the summer, some time, you know, some workshop, what Vanessa will
yeah, I'd love to
will
do
with you, with
I'd love
students.
To
Not
do
only
that.
With our students, for this, I would like to invite some other
this
students from
brain.
Region
this is
to spend
this
some time for, with her, you know, to work a little bit. And
yeah, that would be great.
Yeah.
I'm not very good at teaching. I can...
What is the most important thing?
That I can share.
Okay, Nebojša.
Yeah.
I forgot the year, and about reactions in your speech. What were the circumstances that you gave speech and how, what the reactions were?
Yeah, they were very dramatic experiences. They belong to the 70s. Of course, the political situation in the 70s in the world, in America, and between Israel and the Palestinians in the occupied Palestinian territories, OPT, the official word. That's official to governments anywhere in the world, the occupied Palestinian territories. As you know, they've been occupied since 48, 67, and there is a tragic situation all the time, and at the moment it is, again, particularly awful. I think it's these kind of things are happening in other countries too, which is terrifying. Anyway, I had made a documentary film called The Palestinians, because I thought nobody knows about the Palestinians. And if people knew about the Palestinians, then they'll know more about why all the terrible things are happening, including hijackings of planes and killing of Israeli athletes, also terrible. So I got this film, and I got nominated for playing Julia, and Fred Zinnemann asked me to play Julia. And very possibly the role of my life, much later, I met the daughter of the real Julia, who was not killed, but did exist, the real Julia. She was an American woman. And I always like to mention that because the American government does so many things that are absolutely fatal to many people, including their own people, as do most of their governments, in my view. But there are Americans who do wonderful things. And the story of Julia, which none of you can even know about as a film, but it is a wonderful film because it was directed by Fred Zinnemann, great, great film director. And so I got nominated, and because I was nominated, you get invited by your studio to come out for the Academy Awards, and suddenly everyone's saying, you won't talk about the Palestinians, will you? You don't want to talk about the Palestinians. And I thought, well, I'm not even going to win. But I didn't think of anything except how extraordinary if I did win. Because meanwhile, there were meetings being reported in the press that some mad political and Jewish political fanatics were offering money if anybody killed me. So it was really a very dramatic situation. Anyway, so I went to the awards and turned out, and there was people shouting, and my effigy and Palestinian effigies were being burnt by fanatics in Los Angeles in the front of the, you know, things you just, what's going on in the world today? Today some Bulgarian police killed a refugee on the border. You know, these kind of things are happening everywhere now. So I made a speech in which I thanked Fred Zinnemann for having asked me to be in the film. And it's on record somewhere, so anybody can check what I actually said. It wasn't accurately reported, mostly, but it's on record anyway. And I said that I made a promise that in my life I would fight fascism and anti-Semitism. I would do that all my life. I made that pledge because it seemed that if I had been asked to play this woman who had died and been killed, and of course many, many partisans were killed. Foreign partisans, you name it. Although the real Julia was not killed. So, you know, you kind of feel you owe it to the real people that then someone's made a story about. These true, terrifying, but also when you get to know that finally the stories come out, the letters come out, the diaries come out, the recollections come out, people gather together, oral histories, written histories, and they find out who are these wonderful people. Because there are wonderful people. But we could make some terrible mistakes if we didn't know there were any wonderful people everywhere. And of course, during war is the time you don't hear very much about wonderful people on the side of the enemy, do you? But there are. So that's what I pledged I would do. And, you know, made some mocking remark about a bunch of Zionist hoodlums, gangsters, which is basically what they were. These people who were burning effigies and offering money to assassinate me. I mean, just criminals. And there's a lot of these kind of criminals around, of all kinds of backgrounds and nationalities. A lot of these criminals that are cutting off people's heads, and they're basically criminals. It's nothing to do with a religion. It's nothing to do with nationality. It's due to a lot of things that have been happening. So I made that speech, and Really, that's all I can tell you, except that in those days I can say that from my point of view, not everybody's. In those days, there was much in the 70s, it was a time when young people, and I was still reasonably young, thought of us and them, you know, you're either with us or you're against us. It was a bit of that mentality. And thank God I have had the good fortune to meet and come to know people who don't have that point of view. It's a terrifying point of view. Most governments have that point of view. But an artist can't have that point of view. An artist has to try and understand, like this extraordinary production I saw. Was it only last night that I saw him play Creon in your production of Antigone?
Yeah, it was.
In Sarajevo, and there was students from here in Rijeka in the production. Are you? Oh, great. And some students from Sarajevo and some actresses, of course, Katarina playing the mother from Croatia, and Maya playing Antigone from Sarajevo. The playing and the text and the understanding that formed this extraordinary production, which really is Sophocles' answer to the question, why did the dictator Creon put a girl who wanted to bury her brother? She didn't want to commit a terrorist act, but why did he treat her as if she were a terrorist and wall her up? Now, you could simplify things and say that's why Sophocles wrote his play, because there were a lot of terrorist actions happening in his times, perhaps, and dictators, certainly. So, seeing the production, as with the best work, certainly makes you feel, but it makes you think, And I came to think, and I was saying it to Lenka and Radha at supper afterwards, I think they made, and Sophocles, and the students, and the whole cast, and the brilliant, there's Tiresias there too, and the brilliant costumier set, music, my God, the music. I said, I think you made a kind of survival kit for us in the audience. Because I think working in the theatre is actually a survival kit. I wouldn't say that too often, and I'm only saying it to you because I'm with these two who are a survival kit all on their own. Thank you. Lovely, thank you.
Okay. We can keep drinking our tea downstairs.
But we've made another film, a documentary, commissioned by the St. John of Jerusalem Eye Hospital. It's a charity. The main hospital is in East Jerusalem. There are two hospitals in Gaza, and the hospital in Nablus in the West Bank, and an outreach mobile. surgical, everything that goes out and around, and does extraordinary work that's very much needed, because the eye disease and diabetes and stress, which produces problems for the eyes and all those things. And they train Palestinian doctors and nurses, and they, for the purpose of this training, they work with, although they have their own identity, their own vehicles, their own hospitals, they work with an Israeli university hospital, the Al-Hadassah Hospital. And as both, as leading, the leading doctors who are involved in both the university hospital, the training, and in the St. John's Eye Hospital group. They put the medicine and the needs of the patients before politics, which means quite simply they have their own political ideas. But the ethic is we serve everyone, whatever their nationality. And if an Israeli soldier needs eye operation, they'll do an eye operation. And if a Palestinian has been shot because they threw a stone, they will tend the Palestinian. And it seems to me that this is absolutely the only way to go about, I mean, apart from our work, which I hope we can do some things to change. Some things to change and help human feelings and thoughts, nourish them and stop them dying. The human thoughts and feelings. So, thank goodness there are people still who are doing work to help us think, and are doing work that says, I'm me, and you're you, but my goodness me, I need you and you need me to help solve this situation. So, there's the full answer to your question. Okay, thank you.